Good morning. A very warm welcome to church. It's Sunday the 7th of June. This is the 12th Sunday where our churches have been in lockdown. And today is Trinity Sunday, always follows on from Pentecost Sunday, an opportunity to remind ourselves what it is we believe in Father, Son and Holy Spirit. Now Stephen Dre has the unenviable task this morning of sharing a few thoughts with us, and really look forward to what Stephen has to share a little later. I've not had a preview, so I shall sit and listen and enjoy, as many of you will. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Paul Carr. I'm the minister at Emmanuel Church. I'm the team rector in Billericay and Little Burstead. And wherever you're looking from, watching from rather, we have people in Billericay, across the UK, across the world. We pray that you will enjoy your time with us, and that you will draw closer to God in the midst of all that we share. So it is Trinity Sunday, so a lot of our liturgy and a lot of our songs will echo that theme. And the first song we sing this morning is "In the Name of the Father, in the Name of the Son, and the Name of the Spirit, Lord, we come."
Oh, yourself.
And so we pray together. We have come together as the family of God in our Father's presence to offer him praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive his holy word, to bring before him the needs of the world, to ask his forgiveness of our sins, and to seek his grace, that through his Son Jesus Christ we may give ourselves to his service. Amen. And we bow our heads as we continue in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of worshipping together this morning, and the fact that we may be a scattered congregation doesn't mean that by your Spirit you can't touch our hearts and draw us closer to you. We pray especially this morning for those who are in hospital, those who are unwell, those who are struggling with life and lockdown at this moment. We pray your peace upon them. May they know your comfort wherever they are. May they be aware of our thoughts, of our love, and of our prayers. We pray especially for those who are working. And just, Father, may they know your presence with them on this Sabbath day. But, Father, as we worship together, may we know so much more about how you love us and the plans that you have for us. And the prayer for this Holy Trinity Sunday. Holy God, faithful and unchanging, enlarge our mind with the knowledge of your truth and draw us more deeply into the mystery of your love, that we may truly worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And so we continue in our worship together.
Our Father everlasting, Thee, O creating One, God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into Saints' communion, and in your holy
Stephen has particularly asked that we would use the Athanasian Creed in our worship this morning as a lead into his thoughts on the Trinity. It's an abridged version, I have to say. I've never used it before, but that's not to say that I disagree with the contents, because I don't. But if you have a service sheet, it may come up on the screen, we say together. We worship one God in Trinity and Trinity in unity, neither confusing the persons nor dividing the nature of God. For there is one person of the Father, another of the Son, and another of the Holy Spirit. But the Godhead of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit is all one, the glory equal, the majesty co-eternal. What the Father is, so is the Son, and so is the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The reading is from Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 to 20. The Great Commission. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you to the end, very end of the age." This is the word of the Lord.
Our gospel reading today is one of the most well-known passages in the Bible. For those of us who are evangelicals, it probably sits alongside of John 3:16 as determinative of our understanding of our faith. It's a reminder of the church's calling to be a missional people, accompanied by the promise of Jesus' presence with us in helping us meet the task of global evangelization. And it is appropriate that it's our text on the Sunday after Pentecost, for it stands as a powerful reminder of what it means to be a people inhabited by Christ's Spirit. However, this talk is not going to be about mission, well, at least not directly. And the reason for this is that I want to look at a phrase in Jesus' commission that is usually overlooked when this passage is studied, but which I think is the most important part of what Jesus says. I'm referring to his command that we baptize, and I quote, into the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In other words, while Jesus sets before us a program of action, he also summarizes the content of our message. We are to proclaim a God who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and if we fail to do so, our programs and strategies are a meaningless waste of time, or more seriously, can do substantial spiritual damage to ourselves and to others. Now, I would suggest that the fathers of the Christian Church, who drafted the original Athanasian Creed, of which we earlier read an excerpt, understood this. They prefaced the creed with these words: "If anyone wishes to be saved, they must, before anything else, affirm the Catholic faith, which is that we worship one God in Trinity and Trinity in unity." For the fathers, then, to fail to believe in the tri-unity of God meant a person was not a Christian, pure and simple, as far as they were concerned. But I venture to suggest that if I had asked any of you what truth was essential to your salvation or mine this morning, it would have not been a confession of the Trinity. And yet that was precisely what Jesus demanded of his followers then, and I would suggest expects of us now. This would suggest that we need to reset our focus to regain Jesus' own perspective. So I want to spend the rest of our time together seeking to offer some answers as to why confessing the Trinity is absolutely vital to our faith. My first point is this: we are called to worship the God who has revealed himself to us. We're called to worship the God who has revealed himself to us. Now, perhaps I can explain my point in this way. When I commenced my training for Christian ministry, I was required to take a number of courses on the philosophy of religion. These included questions about whether it's reasonable to believe in God and such issues as to how can God allow suffering. These are not unreasonable questions to ask, as I'm sure you appreciate, but they all started from what it seemed to me is the wrong place. Very simply, they began with the philosopher's idea of God. But the philosopher's God, the God of our world and our society, our neighbours and our friends, this self-invention of the human mind is no God at all. It's an idol. Our God is the God who makes himself known, who reveals who he is and what he is like, and who has revealed himself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God in Trinity. So the early leaders of the Christian Church, and above all Jesus himself, are insistent that the only true God is the God who reveals himself to human beings and is not merely a figment of human imaginations. And the revealed God is God in Trinity. So we're called to submit to his self-revelation, and to do anything else is idolatry. But that still begs a question. To many of us, discussions about the Trinity might appear best consigned to ministers' fraternals. Our simple faith, as we might call it and argue, can get by without needing to engage with the intricacies of theological reflection. Simply to confess the Trinity is surely enough. Now, if that is our view, we ought perhaps to pause for a thought when we remind ourselves of the occasion upon which Jesus spoke these words. This is the very last statement that Jesus made before his ascension. Now, when we leave someone we love, especially if we're going to be away for some time, we usually choose our words carefully. We want what we say to be remembered and acted on above everything else that we might have said. So if Jesus used his last moments upon earth to set out his followers' strategy and to summarize the gospel message we're called to proclaim, and that message is that we proclaim a triune God, we surely need to listen very carefully to what he had to say. So without attempting to be exhaustive, and one suspects exhausting, I would like to offer you two answers as to why, for Jesus, our confession of God as Trinity in unity is so vital. The first answer is that the God who reveals himself is a personal God. The God who reveals himself is a personal God. He's not an idea, but a fellowship of persons within the Godhead, into which fellowship he wishes us to be welcomed. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit have enjoyed from eternity past the mutual exchange of love. This love is not self-absorbed, as a relationship between two persons can become, but an outgoing love shared equally between each member of the Trinity. And this is crucial. It is a love that overflows to those made in the divine image. A love which always seeks to enfold us and draw us into the experience, the loving fellowship of the Trinitarian life. Very simply, God wants us, you and me, to know and enjoy him, to love him, and discover his overwhelming delight in us, and to bask in the experience of the ongoing and welcoming fellowship of the three persons into whose fellowship we are introduced. And as we do so, he expects us to learn to love each one as they individually and together make themselves known to us. This can be put very simply. God wants our faith to be characterized by a personal encounter with him, an encounter in which we delight in the mutual delight of the persons of God, and their delight in sharing that life of love with us. This leads to my second point. What is it about the God who has revealed himself to us and invited us into intimacy with him that demands the affirmation of Trinity. While my last point begins to answer this question, I think we can explore this more fully when we reflect upon the drama of what is sometimes called the story of redemption. It scarcely needs me to remind you that the Old Testament is strongly monotheistic. In other words, it declares that there is only one God, and that God is the God who revealed himself to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, and so on. Yet there are hints that there is a complexity in this oneness. At different times in the Old Testament scriptures, there are traces of different persons and roles within the one God. But it is only a trace. However, when we come to the pages of the New Testament, we meet one who is God, yet is distinct from God. One who can speak of his Father, and yet claims to be God. One who claims that he has come from God, at the behest of God, and as God to fulfill God's purposes of love towards us. And one, too, who can refer on his departure in terms that indicate another will come and make his presence known to us, so that, though no longer on earth, God in the person of his Spirit and Jesus' own Spirit will be present with us and in us, though Jesus is physically absent. And that, in a nutshell, was the disciples' own experience. They met with one who was God and yet was distinct from God. And at Pentecost recognized that there was a presence of Jesus that they enjoyed that was distinct from their enjoyment of his earthly ministry and fellowship. But if that was their experience, and of course it's ours, they came to recognize that each of the three members of the Trinity fulfilled different roles, but that each role was necessary to their salvation. They understood that the Son had been sent by the Father as part of his eternal and loving purpose for fallen humanity. They witnessed the obedience of the Son and were eyewitnesses of the means by which humanity was restored to friendship with God in the cross. And they experienced the Spirit of Father and Son as the one who transformed their inner life, so that the results of Jesus' ministry became a profound experience at the very core of their own beings. They were awakened to spiritual life and sustained by the Spirit in the life of obedience and faith. They were equipped with resources to live in the love of God, to become like him, and to witness to him. Put another way, they came to delight in the ever-deepening mysteries associated with the way in which each person of the Trinity became personal and real and delightful to them. The more they reflected on what God had done as three persons, the more their spirits quickened, the more their devotion deepened, the greater delight they experienced sharing fellowship with each person of God revealed as three in one. But, and this is vital, they recognized that without the work of each member of the Trinity in their lives, the gospel would disintegrate into dust. Without the Father's commission, the Son's obedience, and the revelatory work of the Spirit, the gospel was, one might say, dead in the water. So why do we need to affirm the Trinity? We do so out of obedience to what God has revealed himself to be. In and of itself, this should be enough for us to confess it. But more than that, we do so because only the Trinity of persons could have planned, accomplished, and applied to us the great work of salvation. But finally, we affirm the Trinity because as we immerse ourselves in the fellowship of the Trinitarian life, we find ever-deepening delights to be found in knowing each one. A delight that eternity itself will never exhaust. Our spiritual longings will there be met, but though filled, stimulated to fresh desires and to discovering and enjoying ever new delights in the love of the Father Son, and Holy Spirit. The final word then is this: we affirm the Trinity, for in the fellowship of the three we will find all that our hearts have ever desired or longed to be.
For Trinity Sunday, let us remember the Creator God who made every human being in his own image. We were made to reflect the breathtaking beauty of a multicoloured creation. Help us to share with others all the gifts you have given us. You sent your Son to be with us on earth, and he paid the ultimate price so we can live in freedom. Let us not take that for granted. O Holy Spirit of God, we thank you that you are with us at all times and in all places, for the guidance you give us, the knowledge that you have given us, and for your continual upholding, strengthening and protecting power. We thank you that you are with us, Spirit of God. May the blessing of God, the Father, Son and Holy Spirit, the three in one and the one in three, be on us now and stay with each one of us always. We pray that through this difficult time, people call out to you and find a place in their lives for you. There is only one hope, one Lord, one Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, give wisdom and understanding to all those in authority. May you guide them in the difficult decisions they make on a day-to-day basis. May we all be kept safer from further illness or harm as a result of your intervention. We remember all those of our friends and families, neighbours and others in our community who are ill or working in difficult circumstances. Bring comfort to them and give them your peace. Let us take a few moments of reflection for those people we know personally and lift them to you. So bringing all these prayers together, let us say the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
I hope you've managed to download the service sheet for this Holy Communion for Trinity Sunday. That you also have some bread and wine available, or a non-alcoholic drink, so that we are able to share this act of worship together. So let us in silence remember our faults and failings. Holy God, who calls us to a life of love, have mercy on us. Jesus Christ, who died to show us the meaning of love, have mercy on us. Holy Spirit, who breathes upon us the breath of love, have mercy on us. We confess to God, and in the company of all God's people, that our lives and the life of the world are broken by our sin. So may God forgive us, Christ renew us, and the Spirit enable us to grow in love. Amen. We come together in the presence of Almighty God. We come with our needs and bring with us the needs of others. We come to Almighty God, who comes to us in Jesus, and who knows for himself what human life is like. We come with our faith and with our doubts. We come with our hopes and with our fears. We come as we are because it is God himself who invites us to come. And Almighty God has promised to meet us here. Lord Jesus Christ, present with us now, for all that you have done and all that you have promised. What have we to offer? Our hands are empty. Our hearts are sometimes full of wrong things. We are not fit to gather up the crumbs from under your table. But with you is mercy and the power to change. So as we do in our places this morning, what you did in the upstairs room, send down your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine, that as symbols of your body, they may bring healing and forgiveness, making us whole and enabling us to become your body, loving and caring in the world until your kingdom comes. Among friends gathered round the table, Jesus took bread, broke it and said, "This is my body. It is broken for you." And later he took the cup of wine and said, "This is the new relationship with God made possible through my death. Take this, all of you. Holy God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Jesus Christ, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Holy Spirit, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. So come to this table to meet the living God, love indescribable and beyond our imagining, yet closer than our own breathing. Come to this table to meet the risen Christ, flesh of our flesh, born of our born, Emmanuel, God with us, embodied in our living. Come to this table to meet the life-giving Spirit, interpreting our search for truth and justice, breathing into us renewing power. Come to find, to meet, to hold the living God through bread and through wine. Thanks be to God. And so together we share bread and wine as our act of worship. So we pray together. Almighty and eternal God, you have revealed yourself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and live and reign in the perfect unity of love. Hold us firm in this faith, that we may know you in all your ways, and evermore rejoice in your eternal glory, who are three persons, yet one God, now and forever. Amen. And so we continue our worship this morning. And even though we may be in lockdown, even though life is a struggle in so many different ways, there is an endless song that echoes in our souls. How can we keep from singing the praises of Almighty God?
Echoes in my soul. troubled times sing when I win. I can sing when I lose my step and I fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up. Sing 'cause you're there.
So may the Lord bless you and keep you. Amen. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. Amen. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. And may God, the Holy Trinity, make you strong in faith and love. Defend you on every side and guide you in truth and peace. And so may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you, those whom you love and those who you are praying for this Trinity Sunday and always. Amen. It's been really good to have you with us again this morning. Thank you to Steve and those who have taken part in our worship. Thank you to Richard, who's put it all together as seamlessly as ever. We really do appreciate all that he has done for us over the weeks. As always, keep an eye on Twitter and Facebook, our website. There's always articles to read and updates to be taken. Note of, if you're not on our WhatsApp group and you'd like to be, just send me an email or check out Emmanuel CM12 WhatsApp and we'd be delighted to add you. It's a bit of fun, issues for prayer, all sorts of things. You know how it works. I pray the Lord's blessing on you this week, particularly those children who are back to school, those who are working just as the lockdown sort of relaxes a bit. As I always say, be safe and be blessed, and we'll see you soon. Bye-bye.
presence, my light.
The Lord met the light of his face, and the goodness of his heart to be bricked upon you.
The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
The Lord bless you
and keep you.
The Lord make his face
to shine upon you
and be gracious to you.
The Lord lift up his countenance upon you
and give you peace.
أباركك الرب ويحرسك.
Niech się Pan błogosławi i strzeże.
Faka să lumineze fața lui peste
Fihoneca.
Jehova, tirumukham nindamelu yarti. Nenaka samad.
Kosi fuini alafia.